Hospitals generate a lot of dirty laundry, from patient gowns to bed sheets to cleaning rags. Some do the washing in-house, but the trend is to free up hospital space and send out to industrial-sized laundry operations that deal in high volume and have bigger and better equipment. Bed linens, towels, patient gowns, bibs, cleaning rags. The hospital sends all fabric items to the laundry, except for surgical linens, which are usually disposable. The laundry company's truck picks up the order and delivers it to the plant, where workers unload the bags of soiled laundry on large rolling carts. They weigh each one for internal statistical purposes and scan its barcode to track the laundry traffic per hospital. Workers handling the bags wear gloves at all times. The bags are plastic, which is better than cloth at containing liquid, odor, and bacteria. Workers rip each one open and, without touching the contents, dump them on the conveyor. They discard the bag in a suction device that sends it to a baling system. The bales of bags go to a recycling facility that turns them into garbage bags and other polyethylene products. From this point on, until the clean laundry's sorted, everything is automated. The conveyor drops the soiled laundry into a sturdy cloth bag. Once the bag is holding 55 kilograms worth, the conveyor automatically stops loading until this bag leaves and a new one arrives. The filled bag travels to an overhead conveyor system, leading to one of several stainless steel, tunnel-shaped washing machines. Inside, a large rotating screw pushes the load through two pre-soaks, six chemical wash cycles designed to remove tough stains such as blood and iodine, five treatment cycles to soften the fabric and normalize the pH level, then three rinses. The load of now clean laundry exits the tunnel washer and enters a hydraulic press that works like one of those plunger-style coffee pots. The press applies the weight of a couple of large African elephants, squeezing out the residual water. The load comes out compressed into what they call a cake. A conveyor transfers it to an elevator, which transports it to the drying area. The conveyor puts two cakes at a time into the dryer. An infrared sensor inside signals the dryer to stop when the load is dry, usually about 22 minutes later. A revolving paddle, called a cake breaker, separates the stuck-together items to prepare them for sorting. From this point on, automation ends and manual sorting begins. Workers pull different categories of items, tossing them into designated linen hoppers hooked up to scales. When a bag hits the target weight, it automatically drops down onto a conveyor, leading to the final processing area, where items are either folded or bulk packaged in plastic bags. Workers load the bulk items into a vacuum system, which feeds automated bagging machines. The machines have either a built-in scale, which weighs the bag as it fills, or a photocell, which counts the items dropping into the bag. Once the bag reaches the target weight or count, the machine heat seals, then releases it. Certain items have to be folded. Who wouldn't love to have a machine like this at home? It automatically folds bed pads, bath towels, and patients' gowns, flipping over the ends with short blasts of air. A different folding machine folds larger items, such as bed sheets and flannel blankets. A worker clamps an item to the feeder. Then the machine, through a system of rollers and straps, moves it this way and that until it's neatly folded. The clean laundry goes back onto carts, back on the truck, and back to the hospital. Life on the concert circuit can be punishing, not just for the musicians, but for their instruments. Dents, scuffs, and general wear can ruin the tone of a brass instrument. But with a professional restoration, a badly damaged horn can once again shine in the spotlight. They may look ready for the scrap heap, but incredibly, these not-so-gently used brass instruments can be salvaged. Technicians will use a combination of techniques to make them look and sound like new. The restoration work starts with the solid steel ball. The technician inserts it in the bore of the saxophone, just under some deep dents. He places a plastic sheet on the dents from the outside. It protects the finish from scratches as he now moves a powerful magnet over the dents. The magnet pulls the ball against the inside of the instrument with such force that it pushes out the dents. After 30 seconds of this magnetic manipulation, the dents are completely gone. Using a series of engraving tools, another member of the team restores the artwork on the instrument. He follows the traces that remain and relies on his own creativity where the designs have completely worn away. He has only one chance to get this right. After all, he can't erase it and start again. This takes skill and a steady hand. The next technician reattaches a keycup to the hinge rod and melts solder into the joint to make the connection permanent. The brass is looking very tarnished, so he buffs the keycup and rod to a mirror finish. What a contrast to an unpolished key below. He now attaches the restored key and rod to the saxophone and screws it into position. He presses the end of the key lever to confirm that it moves as it should. He now inserts a fluorescent light into the body of the saxophone. It will help him find air leaks momentarily. But first, he activates an adhesive with a torch and applies it to the back of a leather pad. He pries an old and deteriorated pad out of one of the keycups. He transfers the new glue-backed pad to the keycup. He closes the key against the tone hole, and the escaping light indicates a leak. So he heats the pad to reactivate the adhesive and shifts it a bit in the keycup. Now the key completely closes the tone hole when pressed. The next thing to be repaired is a key guard foot that's broken away from the horn. This is delicate work, and to re-solder it, the technician uses a hydrogen gas torch, because its flame is more precise. At another station, a new part takes shape. They carve a brass cylinder to transform it into a new spring barrel for a trumpet valve. He inserts the spring barrel into the top of the piston, and the fit is good. He then places all the trumpet valve parts in a water and solvent solution. He switches on an ultrasonic device, which sends high-frequency sound waves through the solution. Microscopic bubbles bombard the parts and remove oil and grease, which just float away. The trumpet now chills in a cryogenic freezer, where it's an icy minus 185 degrees Celsius, to relieve it of residual stresses. Back to room temperature, the technician inserts a tiny camera into the bore of the horn. It gives him an inside look at the alignment of the piston's ports as he presses the valves. As with any instrument, the proof is in the playing. This sax is sure to meet the approval of crowds of music lovers.